Broadcasting from beautiful South Florida, welcome to another episode of Your First Thousand Clients, the show that focuses on how to create success first for yourself and then all the people in your world. Your First Thousand Clients is hosted by CEO advisor and best-selling author, Mitch Russo. Listen as Mitch and his inspiring guests share how to turn your hidden assets into a rich recurring revenue stream. Discover revenue streams you never had, increase continuity profits, and help you acquire extraordinary value for your company and family. And now, here's your host, Mitch Russo.
Welcome to another episode of Your First Thousand Clients. I'm your host, Mitch Russo. This show is about you. It's designed to get you to the next level, to take the next step, and to excel past your current perceived limitations by learning from others who already have achieved what you want. Each show is packed with wisdom from company owners who have exceeded their goals and now want to help you achieve yours. Today's guest wrote a book that sold a million copies. Normally, a business book is considered a bestseller with less than 5,000 copies. But here's the reason why it sold so many copies and has become required reading throughout Silicon Valley. It's because my next guest specializes in raising capital, negotiating deals, and is widely known as an expert in all aspects of closing sales. But that's old news. Today, he's going to talk about his new book, a new book that after reading just one chapter has already changed the way I think about selling and closing sales forever. With this powerful paradigm shift, which he will explain in detail, almost anyone who currently sells anything, and that means you, is going to want to pay attention because this one interview may just shift everything for you. Strap in, belt up. We have a wild ride ahead. Welcome, Oren Klaff, to the show.
Mitch, that was a nice introduction. I'm going to have to hire you. I probably can't afford you as an introducer.
Oh, well, my pleasure. And after this book, I think you can afford just about anything you want. So I hope so for you. Anyway, listen, it is such a joy to have you on the show. We met once, as I mentioned, at Camp Maverick some years ago. You told an amazing story about buying your son a Jeep before he was old enough to drive and the joy that you had over the years in sharing that with him.
Yeah, absolutely. That's a great story. Thank you for remembering that. Yeah, and it was good to meet you at Maverick. Absolutely.
Well, it's amazing because you're a super successful guy. And like many of the people who appear on the show, we all have a beginning. And so I think listeners would just love to hear the beginning of how your career started and how you got to where you are today.
Yeah, I think no great story starts with, I think I'll have a salad, right?
I don't think so.
Yeah. So many years ago, I had a software company, and we were before the internet. It was packaged software, CD-ROM, sort of data analysis kind of company, and was growing fast. And it was myself, my partner, and we were in Florida, and we moved out to Southern California, and we added 10 people. Then we added 15 people, and pretty soon we're at 70 people doing almost $10 million annually. And there wasn't much venture capital at that time. It was mainly devices, hardware, maybe a little bit of software, but it was certainly not like it is today where every nine-year-old knows where to go to raise $3 million. And we started running out of money because we were growing too fast and we didn't have a pro forma or a financial model or a marketing plan. We were just selling software.
What year was that, Oren?
So that would have been 95, 96.
Okay.
Internet would have just been turning the corner, but there wasn't any internet distribution. And when you sell into retail, you get paid on a lumpy cycle and you were adding employees. So we just started growing ourselves out of cash. And so as we started running low on cash, somebody said, oh, you need to raise money. So I started talking to venture capitalists and some private equity and Wall Street. And they said, where's your pro forma? What are your KPIs? What are your key assumptions? Right? Let me see your model. What's the marketing plan? What's the business plan look like? And we didn't have any of that. So in 2 weeks, it's a pretty tall order to make all that stuff, especially when you've never done it before. And as much as people wanted to give us money, we couldn't produce the things that they wanted to see. We ended up wrapping up the company and sort of sunsetting it. It wasn't an implosion, but it wasn't a continuing affair. We just sunset it over a period of time. But that wounded me. That sort of somewhat of a failure around the area of finance. There became a hole in my heart, which said, I need to know how finance works. How do you raise money, right? And then I went on to raise from there $6 million for a company, and then $8 million, and then $30 million, and then $47 million. And then a partner and I went on to raise $500 million on a 1.5 year run. And so I got it figured out. And then what I learned from that is that when you're raising money, so if you're in sales or you're in marketing, how does this apply to me? You know, how do I get Oren Klaff off my headphone or speakers right now and listen to something better? But the reality is, when you're raising money, you're selling equity or a note from the company. It is the most extreme form of selling. So it's not something magical about raising money. You're selling the product, which is the company, and you're trying to obtain a commodity, which is money. And it informs all other kinds of selling. It's the most extreme form because people say, what's the difference between a pitch and a sale? When you go to pitch, you're going to a bank, you're going to a private equity firm, you're going to a customer, you have one bite at the apple, right? And you have what you have. You have to present it to them in the best light possible, right? When you're selling, you have a service or product that can be form-fitted in many ways to the needs of the buyer.
Isn't that the idea of selling in general? I mean, don't we want to make sure that we know our prospect well enough to know what they need, what their pain points are, and how to take what we have and convey it in a way that solves their problem?
Sure. And it makes life a little bit easier to do it that way. But when you're raising money or selling a deal, you have what you have. You can't conform a piece of real estate to the buyer.
True.
Right? You can't conform a software company to the needs of the buyer. So it's a very instructive form of selling because you don't have the benefit of sort of features and benefits of making the thing you're selling fit the buyer's needs, right? You just have to explain it in a way that's as compelling as possible so they and run a process where they want what you have.
Yep.
Now you take those same rules or skills or methods or ideas and you apply them to everyday selling and you really get an incredibly powerful tool set or skill set. So that's what I've done is I've taken the things that work in money and let people apply them to everyday sales. And the results are amazing.
Well, it would make sense. I mean, like you said, it's sort of like the marathon highest form, most difficult way to sell anything is by raising money. And amazingly, our lives had run on parallel tracks for a little while. I too started a software company before the internet. I did sell packaged software. I actually sold it retail. I sold it through Egghead Discount Software and eventually to corporations as well. But I grew that company also to around $10 million, but I sold it. At that point, I was ready to go and we found an amazing buyer and we took advantage of that. And now, of course, now that I know you, the only thing I could think of is I probably didn't get enough for it.
Yeah. You know, that's the other thing is a lot of people can sell what they have, raise money and everything like that, but it's not can you do it or can you complete the sale, but at what terms
do
you do it? At what terms? And so if you could get better terms with the way you present, the way you pitch, the way you sell, then you've had a success. So once you move beyond I can sell or I can raise money into what terms can I get? What are the best terms I can get? Then you really start to see people be successful.
Of course. And I guess in your life, you transitioned from a software company to helping others raise money, raise capital for their venture, whatever that might be, whether it, as you said, real estate or even other software companies or technology companies. Is that right?
Yeah. So I think what's instructive for people listening, you know, if I think, hey, I'm listening, what can I take away from this is when you are going in and asking for a resource, right? You have to do a couple things that are needed, whether it's money or a sale or a contract, or you're trying to get hired. Right?
Yep.
And it's got to become a process where A, you've got their attention. B, they believe you're an expert. Right? And C, they don't have the desire to go look around and try and find what you do at a better price. And so if there were KPIs, you know, those are the things you have to create that aren't there naturally. Attention.
Yep.
Very limited, more so today, of course, than ever. Expertise. You know, it's funny. I'll tell you a quick story. I was trying to buy some video editing SaaS plugin software for some of the videos we're doing on social media. Because when you go up to Instagram it sort of, it wants you to format in a certain way, and then you got to format it for Facebook in a different way. It just takes a lot of time to do all this formatting. And there's some software So anyway, I'm chatting with a company about their service, and it's technical stuff, right? It's got to be at 60 hertz at a faster than 30 frame rate, but not faster than 60. It has, you know, can't be more than 59 seconds and 59 milliseconds. And there can't be certain Facebook. There can't be text on certain. It's very technical. Mm-hmm. So I'm chatting with a guy, and he says, yes, we can do that. Yeah, that's easy for our software. Yeah, all you do is you use our plugin. And I said, listen, you're a very nice guy on chat, but it sounds like you're new there. You got to escalate me to someone who knows what they're doing. Okay, it's the technical stuff. Mm-hmm. And the guy writes back, I'm the founder. Right. And so the point is there that if you don't have a model to communicate that you're an expert in the customer's problem, then within the pitch or the sale, you can't even move on to giving features and benefits and trial close and objections and overcoming objections and closing and all that kind of stuff. None of that matters until the buyer believes a couple things about you. Until his belief system about you is changed, there's no point in doing a traditional old style, old script kind of sale.
Sure. So what could that guy have done specifically to have prevented you from thinking that he wasn't qualified to answer your questions?
Yeah, so that's a great question. I mean, I think as I've dedicated the first couple chapters in the new book, is first, he should have communicated that he's a insider to the problem that I have. There's somebody's going to view you in one of two ways, right? Mm-hmm. That you're an insider to their problem or an outsider who touches on it but isn't intimate with the problem.
Okay.
You know, I'll give you an example of that in a moment. And the way to do that is to talk in the language of the buyer. How does the buyer talk to another person in his business? If you can talk in that language, then you'll be viewed as an insider. So until you're viewed as an insider, buyers will be very skeptical of you, right? They want to move very slowly and very resistant to the assertions, you know, to believing the assertions that you make. So Mitch, what kind of car? You're a car guy. What kind of car do you drive?
I drive a Jeep Grand Cherokee.
Oh, that's a great car. All right. Is it brand new or got a couple years on it? Or
brand new.
Brand new. Okay. Brand new Jeep Cherokee. You hear a noise, okay? You hear a noise coming out of it. And so you take it down. The Jeep dealership is actually quite a distance. So you take it down to a shop and they go, yeah, it's making a noise. Sounds like it's coming from the fan area. Why don't you leave it here? And Mitch will give you a call tomorrow. It's $200, right? And if we end up working on it for the assessment, we'll credit that $200 towards the service work. And you go, that doesn't sound too good.
No.
So you go down the road to the next shop, drive it in. Guy listens in. There's a little squeaking coming. Puts his hands, mechanic, you know, looks like a real mechanic. Got a couple tattoos up his left arm and puts his hands in his pocket and kind of touches the tire with his toe. Mm-hmm. You know, he says, hey, he tells you to get back in your car, hit the gas a little bit while it's and the fan squeaks. Come out and goes, listen, what you got there? That's a 25-37-3 fan belt. They probably put on the 25-37-3R because they ran out of them, you know, at the factory from March and April last year. You know, this one you probably took delivery in April. There's just about 200,000 of these made. You know, we see them quite frequently because most of them are sold in this area. The replacement for that isn't really available yet, but we've adapted a 17-53-4 from the prior model Jeep Cherokee, which is a perfect fit. We've done about 1,500 of those. You know, if you leave your car here, I've got 50 in the back. I can have the 27-43. And also it looks like you got a little bit of an oil leak. We got a tension, the rod tensioner, probably another 2 or 3 Newton meters. You know, we'll throw that in. It's $400. If you come back at 5 o'clock, I'll have your car ready.
Done.
Yeah. Right. And so that's what I wanted to hear.
Yep.
Right. Oh, hey, you're uploading to Instagram. You probably need to be at 60 hertz. You're probably getting the, you know, when you're using Hootsuite, you're getting the double fail rate on both LinkedIn because the character count is different on both. If you get the 30 frame rate, get the characters into two different posts and split those in half, we can get the text off of those and uploaded to both Instagram, Facebook, and LinkedIn in a 50 millisecond, repeater pattern and have that up. You won't have the problem anymore. where do I sign up?
Right.
So I think what happens is we think buyers are the old kind of buyers that are dumb, right?
Yep.
They don't know much. But the reality is they know as much or more in some cases than you, the seller. They're very technical. they don't want to be taught about fan belts or about Hertz rates or about accounting software or whatever it is you do. Mm-hmm. What they want is to know that you're an expert and that you're technical and that you've solved their problem from the insider position 1,000 times. And until you can communicate that and show them, right? Not tell people. So I think a lot of people try and tell folks, buyers, that they're an expert. These are our accounts. We work for Microsoft. We've been around since 1996. These are our customer logos. These are the likes we have. You know, but every other competitor has those same likes and logos and customer accounts and success stories and everything like that. Not that they're bad, but when you're selling, you're telling someone you're good, you're an expert. You're not showing them. Show people that you speak the language of their problem. You've solved that kind of problem 1,000 times. You know, and the book kind of shows you many different ways that you can take a buyer through that journey of believing that you're an expert that can solve his kind of problem.
Of course, but you still need to be that expert, right?
So I think you need to either be that expert or have that expert.
Okay.
On hand. So many times, I mean, we win or lose deals on this account, right? If somebody comes in and they're a semiconductor company and they want us to help them a fabulous semiconductor company, and they want to sell the company or raise money. If we don't speak semiconductor internally from someone in here, an analyst or a junior account manager or somebody, we'll more than likely lose that account if we can't speak. I mean, and not for minutes and hours and get super technical, but if we can't speak 100, 200 words of semiconductor. Oh, that's a 0.01 micron semiconductor that has a, the processing power of the AMD forthcoming chip, but it's 10% faster. So you got a 2 years competitive advantage because of the IP barriers that you've licensed in which in neither Intel or AMD, you know, will be releasing until 2022 based on the recent filing. I don't know, it's 150 words. Unless we can speak their language, we lose the account. People want to know that you're an insider and you're an expert before they know what the features of your product or service or idea are.
It makes total sense. I mean, and again, it's the analysis of what happens every day that people generally don't pay attention to. Salespeople learn scripts. Salespeople go down a pathway. They follow others who've been down that pathway and learn from them. So what you're doing basically is you're cracking the code of and giving people the freedom to basically understand this process at a much deeper level. And honestly, that's what your first book did. It talked about frames. It talked about all the ways that you would handle different situations. But what I'm fascinated about is what the second book talks about. I love the movie analogy. I was going to let you share that because it's so brilliant. Why don't you explain not just how that works, but how you did it?
Yeah. So I think the way I've referred to it is as inception, right? We don't want to tell somebody what to think, ask them to buy from us, do a close on them. You know, I don't really know any closes and say, so are you in? That's what we have. You know, what do you think? And then the buyer goes, well, I don't know. And then the only tools you have to really drive the sale forward is discounting, right? So if you think, well, if I have to ask the buyer to say yes or to buy or to agree with me, and he does agree. If you're an executive or you're a sales guy and you've been in business any amount of time, just because somebody says yes doesn't mean you have a deal, right? When you ask someone, so what do you think? If we could get you it in color red, if we could get you the 2073 server stack for the price of the 2321s, would you be ready to go ahead? Yeah, Mitch, I would. I'll take that server stack. That you may be as far from a sale as when you started. Because when people agree with something you propose to them, it is a delicate agreement. It's a delicate relationship. It's very sensitive. And more often than not, the decision can be reversed. And you're sort of chasing that thing still to close. And you can chase your tail for a long time. So what I discovered is when somebody comes up with the idea that they want to work with you, and they come up with that idea on their own, it's inception, that it's created within them. And they go, so Mitch, I really like this. How do we get started? That does not require a discount. It's going to be incredibly stable. It's going to be based on a relationship. And that deal is going to go through. So the question was, how do we create inception inside of someone So we're never doing a trial close and they're spitting out objections. We're trying to overcome objections and we're saying, hey, Mr. Jones, press hard. Fifth copy's yours. This is the kind of joke, you know, from the olden days. And, you know, if you mention the car dealership, you know, the general manager with the buyer of a new car sitting there, you know, so Mitch, handing you a pen, press hard. The fifth copy's yours. So how do we put these ideas in someone's mind so they can arrive on their own to the desire, the wanting, and the suggestion to buy from you, to work with you, and to close the sale? And so that was the question. And the answer was to put the things that the buyer needs to know about you into their mind in a very specific process. So in the order in which, you know, buyers buy when they get information in the order that they need it, in the amount of detail that is they can consume for that meeting or Skype call or phone call or presentation or whatever it is. So again, buyers buy when you give them the information they need in the order that they need it, in the amount of detail that they need it. So that was the question. How do you do that? You know, it's funny. Say to me, you know, Oren, what happens when somebody is, you know, looking at their phone or interrupts you during a presentation or meeting or a speech? And I say, well, you know, I don't know, because people don't look at their phones when I'm in meetings because I'm giving them the information they need at that moment to move to the next moment. When people believe they know what you're going to say next, why you're going to say it, or they've seen it before, then they start to check their phone because they're bored.
Right.
And so when you give people the information a certain way and you guide them through a sale, then you can make these sales, you can close these things without ever getting to that really awkward, uncomfortable, high pressure point where you're done your presentation and now you're just talking about price, right? And that's where most sales go to die, is when the presentation is over and then they say, how much is it? And you say, well, you know, it depends. And now it's the things all over the place. And then they'll just say, oh, well, you know, this looks really good. If you can send us over the presentation and a proposal, I'll take this to the committee. I'll take this to the CFO, the CEO, the board of directors, my partners, some mythical approval committee that I just made up so I don't have to make a decision here. And then they'll take your proposal and your pricing and they'll go to the internet and they'll look for the same thing free or less, right? And then literally, you know, you're familiar with it, you know, shopping a proposal.
Of course.
So when we get a price from a bank on a deal, you know, a $5 million loan or, you know, piece of equity or whatever, they're very sensitive because they know how valuable that term sheet is, right? If they give you a definitive term sheet with a price on it, they're very aware that you're going to take that and shop. So you'll see a no shop clause, right, in a lot of these things, or they want to at least have a relationship with you, because having a term sheet from a bank, $5 million at such and such rate, at such and such terms, most people are going to take that, shop it, and try and better get a better rate on it.
Of course.
And so that's what you want to avoid at all costs, is being shopped, right? Being put in a box saying, you know, one thing around here that I will not let the salespeople say is, or agree to, they make a pitch for a deal. And if the buyer or prospect or, you know, whatever potential customer says, okay, well, you know, that's good. Now we know what our options are. We'll get back to you if we have any additional questions, or, you know, now we know it's an option, we can figure out what we want to do. We don't allow that. We're not an option that you keep on the shelf. We're not in a box that you take out, you know, when you want to look at it. We invest a lot in our potential deals. We make the pitch. We apply it to what you're doing. We give you the information, certainly walk you through the KPIs, the assumptions, the pro forma, the features, the benefits, how we do it, what the cost is, what the expectations are, what the deliverables are, all that stuff. And we want to drive forward to a decision. We don't want to keep trying to chase your account around. And so that's what our process does. Is this a customer? Do they have budget? If they do have budget, are they right for us? If they're right for us, can they make a decision on the timeline that works for us? And ultimately, Mitch, we teach them how to buy from us. And that's what this book is about. When you're creating Inception, you're showing somebody how to buy from you. And if they won't follow the rules of how to buy from you, they're not a buyer.
Of course. That makes total sense. Listeners, we are talking with Oren Klaff, the author of Pitch Anything, and his new book, Flip the Script. It's an exciting book, a book that will change the way you sell forever. You can see every word that Oren and I have said today, including a free giveaway that's pretty sensational, on his show page located at yourfirstthousandclients.com. Go to Oren Klaff's show page, and there you will see everything that we spoke about today. Now, Oren, I just want to summarize. What you're doing here, and it's different than just about anybody else who sells, is your goal is to implant the idea that they need this and should buy it from you in their mind without asking for the order. Is that basically the idea?
That is exactly the idea.
Okay. And the way you do that is by answering their questions in advance so that they really should not have any significant questions at all. And the way you portrayed it in the part of the book that I read is that it's almost as if you don't care that much about whether they buy. You're there to show them what you have. And if it's good fit, fine. If it's not, it's not. And you need to grab your Uber and get the heck back to the airport.
That's true. I feel like the thin line that goes between a great sale and a lost sale is on both sides of it. It is caring and not caring. And so how do you straddle that line? Caring about the client, showing them that you're passionate, showing that you're excited potentially about working with them, and at the same time going, I'm just here in the moment, right? I care. I'm interested in this account. I'm excited to be working with you, right? But there's some things about you that make me nervous as well that I really have to clarify while we're here. So ultimately, your job as you get into the inception kind of sale is to say, as much as you're evaluating us as an option to work for your business, provide you services, provide you product, to work together, to sell you our products, we are also evaluating you. Because as you know, taking on a customer is very important to a company. We want good customers who are around for years, and we want to avoid bad customers. And we like you. We think it's a good account. Microsoft, what else can you say about it? But there's some things that we definitely have to get straight before we're in business together.
So you've flipped it around. In effect, you've gotten to them to the point where now they need to sell you if they want to do business.
Customers absolutely have to be in a position where they recognize you're the best at what you do.
Right.
You're the expert. You're there briefly in the moment. Everybody in the business is roughly a commodity, and you are commodity plus, right? And then we move on to really, they have to understand that as objections start forming in their mind, the answers to those objections should already be pre-answered.
Right.
And so that's an interesting, and that's one of the chapters in the book is pre-wired ideas. Concepts are so complicated today. SaaS software, you know, that does, I mean, there's API plugin for tax accounting software, software that has automatic API plugins that will adapt your database to Amazon's sales system or Shopify through Amazon account management with fraud detection. I mean, these things are hard to explain and they're complex. And whatever it is you do, there's 300 other companies that say they do the exact same thing. There's 7,000 marketing tech companies. If you batch them together in sort of groups of 300-400, every segment has got 400 companies that say they do the exact same thing.
Right.
So as we're fighting this in the business world, I came to this notion. I said, well, what? Well, it's funny. I was listening to a show on the radio, something about the brain, the magnificent brain or something like that. And they were talking about substance abuse. And they said, look, what's interesting is if you think about cocaine, and it's not something I know that much about or anything about, but I was listening to the show and they go, you know, cocaine is not some kind of chemical substance that makes the brain go bonkers, right? The mind or your chemical system has never seen this before. And it gets into the brain and it just stimulates all this stuff and it makes you go nuts. That's not what happens. Cocaine works because there are receptors in the brain that understand the chemical compound of cocaine. It just super saturates them.
Yep.
I was like, oh, that's fascinating, right?
Yep.
That really flipped the whole idea around for me. I just thought, you know, when people took cocaine, that it's a substance that they've never seen before and it just made them go nuts. But the idea that there's things in the body that know what cocaine is and want it and they're pre-wired to receive it. And I said, you know, I wonder if this works in ideas. If this works in ideas, and are there pre-wired ideas? I'm sort of, you know, calling my buddies who are experts in narratives and storytelling. Like I have a friend, David Griffiths, who is a screenwriter, wrote The Hunted and Collateral Damage and, you know, movies you'd be familiar with. And I said, have you thought about this pre-wired ideas? And he's like, Oren, are you an idiot? I'm like, well, yes, I am. Right? He says, yeah, there's seven ideas that a movie has to follow. If it's not one of them, you don't have a movie.
Right.
Right. Man against man against himself, man against nature, man against, you know, whatever. I don't know what the other ones are. Right. Yep. But they're like, you don't have Avengers Infinity War unless you have one of those. Right.
Mm-hmm.
You have a weird little art house movie that nobody wants to see. So there are these themes that are pre-wired in human consciousness that we want to see, understand, and immediately connect with. So I said, wow, is there any way, you know, are there pre-wired ideas in business where I can take, you know, all these complicated semiconductors, genetic software, SaaS software, medical devices, healthcare devices, all that kind of stuff, and compress it into pre-wired ideas that the brain already has channels to accept? You don't have to do a lot of explaining and convincing, right? And overcoming objections.
Right.
So, you know, one of them, and you know, from the book, I don't mind talking about here, was this idea of winter is coming. Winter is coming. And so, Mitch, have you seen any of the Game of Thrones episodes?
Oh, yeah. Loved Game of Thrones.
So, look, Game of Thrones is great. It's not everybody's cup of tea. All you listeners from Utah, sorry. Kind of mean to Utah today. But anyway, but what you know from the show, there's so many characters, so many character arcs, so many plot arcs, so many confusing interconnecting pieces that whenever it got so complex, the storylines, that there was no way to resolve it, they just go back to this winter is coming, this idea that this great freeze, and it organized all the plot arcs and characters to like, hey, when winter comes, you better have friends, you better have food, and you better have somewhere to stay.
Yep.
Otherwise, you're going to freeze to death, right? And yep, that became the organizing principle. And all of a sudden, the story became easy to understand again.
So true. That is so true.
That's what we try and do in our sales, is introduce this idea that a nuclear winter is coming to this industry. And I know you were going to say something there, Mitch, but I just complete my thought. I'll give you an understanding of what nuclear winter is in an industry.
Mm-hmm.
When stadium seating came to the theater industry, it wiped out all other forms of theaters, literally put them out of business in one day. It was a complete nuclear winter. And I'm not talking about the kind of theaters you go to, Mitch, which is they serve sushi and beer and you press a little button and they ask you, would you like pizza or wine? And the thing reclines. I'm just talking about plastic seats, right? Mm-hmm. That are higher than the seat in front of it.
Right.
Like it was in the 80s. So if you were a salesman then in that industry or a consultant, you would come in and say, hey, listen, stadium seating is coming. You have 8 theaters, right? When stadium seating comes to your market, it's going to shut you down, right? You have 8 months before the first one is built and open. And when that happens, you have zero chance. I'm the number one guy who understands how to rapidly retrofit, permit, retrofit, stand up, market, and cost fact the refurbishment of a theater and get a loan for it, right? And you have about 30 days to get started. Otherwise, total annihilation. What would you like to do? I have 20 minutes left.
So that's exactly the way you described it. I love that because that's exactly how you described it in the book. And what you're basically saying is it's your choice. If you want to proceed without my help and you know what will happen without my help, then go ahead. I got a bus to catch. But if you want to take care of this, I got 20 minutes. Let's get it done. But the best part about what you're describing here, and I think the learning moment for me, is that when your research is so complete, when you fully understand exactly who your buyer is better than in some ways, maybe they do, because you probably know the market more thoroughly from your perspective than they ever could. Once you get to that point, then this flip the script concept of the inception game, placing that thought into the buyer's mind, is straightforward, more straightforward than it seems. That's what I'm getting from what you're saying.
Yes, absolutely. And in every industry, I don't care what you're in. I don't care if you're shipping plastic Santas, right? There is some kind of nuclear winter happening today. Tariffs, taxation, moving to the cloud, competitors from overseas, from low-cost, digital competitors from low-cost areas of the world. Every industry has some dramatic change in it that if the players don't adjust, they will become RIM, they will become Xerox, they will become Sony. They were leaders, but when the change came, the company wasn't able to adapt.
Yep.
So if you have somebody understand truthfully, you're not, so this isn't sort of light something on fire and then sell people fire extinguishers, you know, as it used to be in the old school sales. If you have somebody understand that there truly is a change happening in their industry and they could potentially be caught flat-footed on the other side of the change, but you are the expert, which we were talking about earlier, in how things are going to be in the future.
Yep.
That is a pre-wired idea in the minds of people that environments change, you know, winters come, and if you haven't prepared for the winter, you freeze and die.
Absolutely.
I would literally tell a customer, you know, on a $10 million deal, winter is coming. If you don't prepare for winter, you're going to freeze and die. Let me explain.
Well, this is the same exact way I help my clients sell the certification programs that we build together. And we do it in three videos. The world has changed, video number one. Video number two is where the world is going to. And video three is here's the solution that you can have right now that fixes the problem. And this formula has been something that we've used for years, and it works fantastic. It works really, really well every time because it is changing. And like you said before, in any industry, there is always a winter coming, and it's generally pretty identifiable. In many cases, they already know it anyway.
Yeah, that is the challenge that I would give people listening. And certainly the book, you know, has a whole chapter on this, putting what you have into a format that the brain already has receptors for. And that makes your ideas slide right in, be accepted, and without the friction of you having to explain and creating defensiveness or questions or misunderstandings or friction or need for follow-up or technical, have people understand instantly in these pre-wired, pre-existing pathways into appreciation for what you're doing, then you start moving forward towards a sale methodically and easily, right? And you get to the point where you can move on to where you're introducing your product and your features. Let me say this. If you are selling anything for more than a couple months, like, you know what the buyer's objections are. Like, come on, there's not 500 different kinds of objections. I saw, what's the Wolf of Wall Street guy? Jordan. Yeah, Jordan. So Jordan goes, hey, you know, he was talking to some audience. He goes, okay, what's your problem? Well, the buyers have so many objections. Okay, what are the objections? Right? And he kind of went through it. And they're like, oh, they have hundreds of objections. And he said, I bet they don't. And I agree with him. They don't have hundreds of objections, guys. There's five. There's maybe seven. The price is too high. We don't know enough about it.
Restrictive third party. I got to check with so-and-so.
Yeah. I got to check with my partner. What's the other objections that come out? Well, we're not ready, right? I'm not sure we can afford it. It doesn't have one of the features that we were looking for. I don't know. I'm running out of objections.
Yeah, but I get the point. Absolutely. There are just a certain number of objections that once you learn the basic handling, then it's rolling off a log. You just handle it.
Here's what I would say. When you get to a point in a presentation where objections are coming out, they aren't really objections, right? Especially today, they sort of know coming in what it is you have, the technical features of it. You haven't really educated them that much. Mm-hmm. What they're saying is, we don't have certainty about working with you, that the things you say will happen will actually happen. And so objections are a communication of lack of certainty that the outcome will appear as promised. It is very rare that an objection ever gets chased in a sale and you satisfy the objection and then are able to move on with it. That's the olden days. I don't even know if it worked in the olden days. As objection comes out, when you jump out with a wiffle bat, attack the objection, try and beat it into submission, knock to the ground and make a piece of candy come out of the pinata and overcome the objection, it is either not overcome, you know, they agree, oh yeah, you answered my question, but it's not been answered, or in all likelihood, they didn't even really have that objection in the first place. They're just saying, I'm just not into this whole thing and I need to think. And I need to think really means I need to take your proposal and see if I can get it free or cheaper or better somewhere else.
Of course.
So overcoming objections is not a part of the sale that is going to get you closer to closing the deal. And so finding these ways to package your ideas so the mind of the buyer with zero friction says, aha, I believe this expert and I understand what he's saying, why he's saying it, and what he's selling me. And so that's very powerful.
Of course it is. And Oren, I would love to talk to you all day about this because it's fascinating to me. But I have to at this point say that we need to move on to the actual format of the show, which is not just me asking you questions, because I'd love to do that. I want to ask you one important question that has nothing to do with your book. It has to do with you. You see, because I get interested in the people that I interview, and I love everything you said today, but you're an amazing individual. And I would like my readers to get to know you just a little bit better with this next question. So here's the question. Who, in all of space and time, would you like to have 1 hour to enjoy a walk in the park, a quick lunch, or an intense conversation with?
It's like you're saying, hey, what's your favorite movie? And you're a movie connoisseur, and you know, all of a sudden you can't remember a movie. But for me, a very interesting character from history was George Patton, George S. Patton, right?
Yep.
Because I feel like war is the study of the absolute raw edges of human psychology, what people really will and won't do when the pressure is on. I see the same thing around money. But what are those things that these generals in those kinds of wars that we don't have anymore learned? And I would love 1 hour stroll in the park with George Patton. That would be life-changing.
Well, as a consolation prize, I might introduce you to my business partner whose great-great-great-grandfather was George Patton.
Oh, that's fascinating.
Yeah. So he's shown me pictures of him and George Jr. in the backyard of their house in Hamilton, Massachusetts, firing a machine gun into the woods.
Oh, that's incredible. Yeah, I've been to the Patton Museum. It's out here in Scirocco Summit near San Diego. I've flown out there in our plane, and that's super interesting. So I'll take you up on that someday. Very interesting.
Absolutely. All right, Oren, here it is, the grand finale, the change the world question. Are you ready?
Sure, I'm ready.
Okay, here it is. What is it that you are doing or would like to do that truly has the potential to literally change the world?
What I'm doing, and I really feel like I'm giving people the opportunity to step out of the cliche, old school, or instinctive way of getting resources. That's why I think, like, whether you're negotiating, whether you're raising money, whether you're exchanging goods and services for money, you're getting resources and power to do the things you want. So I'm helping people get the power they need by understanding how today buyers will sign a check, wire money, sign the agreement. That's what I'm excited about, is anybody wants to step into this material and really learn how to get the power they need to get things done, I'm here to help.
Well, listeners, you got to get this book. It is absolutely incredible. It's already on my Kindle. It was released this morning. And I will tell you right now that you will thank me when you do, because Oren is an amazing guy and the book is just sensational. Oren, your free gift is actually pretty sensational too. Why don't you tell us what it is that you have in store for listeners?
Yeah, sure. It's funny. I was giving away a free chapter of the book and my partner said, give away more, give away something I would want. I said, I'll give away 2 free chapters. He said, no, give away something awesome that I would want. I go, man, what would you want? He said, I need a half day with you. I go, are you crazy? I don't have a half day. I'm very busy. And he says, that's give away a half day. I go, that's nuts. So it's to give people something that's truly valuable and then participate with you. And so go to orenklaff.com and I'm giving away the opportunity. You can enter and win a half day with me. I'll fly you out to San Diego. I'll put you up on the beach in Carlsbad in a hotel with a beautiful overview of the beach. And we'll drive around whatever, the Lamborghini or the G-Wagon or the Defender or the R8 or whatever it is. You choose a car and I'll help you do some of the things that we talked about here today. Put your ideas, your business, your product, your services into a format that buyers will pay attention to it, love it, want it, and come up with the idea of buying from you before you even have to suggest it. So that's the giveaway.
That's amazing. I hope nobody else enters but me. I think I already entered, so that's it.
You and my mom, it's going to be a tough battle.
All right, well, shut that page down. Oren, this has been so much fun. I really enjoyed the conversation. I really learned something from you today, and I want to thank you for teaching us all what you are now at the cutting edge of, which is how to get behind what a buyer is thinking and show them a way that they can acquire your product and have it be their decision. Thank you for that. And I just can't wait until we get a chance to talk again soon.
Mitch, it's great chat with you. As you said, can go on for hours, but launch day, I'm getting the hook, 2:00.
You got it. All right, my friend, you take care. I'll talk to you soon.
Thanks, Mitch.
Okay.